Good morning, all of you. So as you know, today we have arranged a virtual industrial visit at Byte System, which is located within Nasik itself. And today we have with us the founder of Byte System, Mr. Ghanshyam Bagul sir. So Ghanshyam Bagul sir has completed his BSc in computer science, as well as he has completed his MBA in information technology from Pune University. And he started this company for providing software related services. And he has experience of more than 10 years in computer IT field, software development field. So today we are fortunate that he has with us for providing knowledge regarding Java programming, advanced topic within Java programming. So I welcome Ghanshyam sir in virtual visit on behalf of Guru Gobind Singh Polytechnic and Computer Engineering Department. So thank you so much, sir, for giving your valuable time for guiding our students. And I request to you to start the session and guide our students. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
I am Ghanshyam Bagul, founder of Byte System. I have completed my BSc and MBA from Pune University itself. I have been in this field since last 12 years, from 2009. Primarily, I was running a computer academy, and after that, in 2011, we started a development for Byte System. Byte System is a leading IT company in Nasik, and we are serving our clients across India, and we are working in 5 states and more than 40 cities in India. Primarily, we are working for a company to digitize their business process and increase their profitability. We develop systems to digitize business process and minimize the paperwork in the day-to-day business life. We also provide cloud hosting for a few IT companies, and technically we build almost 95% of our projects in PHP and Android currently. Our esteemed clients include CF Tire, PWD, Maharashtra Government, Yokohama Tires, Adani Steels, Gabriel Limited, Mahindra Motors, Rikem RPG, RPG Life Science, then Pernod Ricard, Shelly Engineering, HS Enterprises. These are the few esteemed clients of Byte System. So I'll share my screen now, and we shall start with our session, which is Java programming, Java advanced programming for Windows development and event handling. Okay. So let's start. I'll share my screen now. If you have any doubt, then I be conducting one question round at the end of session itself.
Okay. Is the screen visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So these are our clients. And this is today's agenda, right? So we are going to see Windows programming and event handling. Okay, in this session, we shall cover frame designing, user interface designing, different user interface controls, and event handling using Java. Okay, so first of all, we shall discuss about the Windows programming and the, you can say, facilities available in Java to design Windows screens. So there are two approaches in Java. Well, first is the AWD, which is old approach, and next is the Swing, that is the new approach. AWD is nothing but abstract Windows toolkit. It's a toolkit, or you can say a package available to design Windows in Java, and it is very dependent on the operating system that you are running. Suppose me, you are using AWD and you are running your program in Windows, then your window or your frame will look like Windows only. And if you run in Linux, then it will be somewhat like to Linux designing. So AWT is a toolkit which was abstracting his look and feel from the operating system. And the new approach to that approach was the Swing. In Swing, you can have your custom themes, and those custom themes was applied to the screen, and the look and feel was different from the operating system, and it is very independent to the operating system. So this is a short description. The focus of this session is the practical aspect of this concept. So we shall move to practical of development. Okay. So the next point is we shall directly explore the package and the classes available in this package. So we shall not talk about anything about AWT. We shall directly jump to Swing because we are focusing on Swing only. So the first class is the JFrame. JFrame, it's a Windows class. That means you can design Windows by using this class. So we are going to see a first program to design a frame. So here I'll first of all tell me, everyone present here, you knows Java, core Java, right? You can answer me in chat box.
Yes.
Yes, you know about the core Java. Now let's see, this is a small program in Java. See, here we have imported a class Java X dot Swing. This is a Swing package, and it provides different classes in Swing package, which are we are using these classes to design user interface. The first class we are going to see is the JFrame class. This class is used to design Windows, and here a simple program is, see, we have a class and we have named this class as form one, right? And this form extends JFrame. That means this form, form one, has all the attributes and functionalities which are available in JFrame. Now it is extending JFrame. So here we have a basic method, right? A main method, public static void main, right? And in main method, we have created object of this class, and we have named this object as F1, and it is initialized, right, like this. And after that, there is a method set visible, okay? And this is F1 object, and we are calling this method set visible on this object, and the parameter provided is true. So now just see what these two statements are going to do. This first statement, form one is our class, and F1 is the object of this class. And this statement will create object of form F1, which is extending JFrame, right? That means F1 is nothing but object of JFrame only. So it will be a JFrame, and we are calling a set visible method. What this method does, this method will make visible the form, because by default, when we create a form using JFrame class, the default visibility will be invisible. So we shall not see that frame, and to see that frame or to see that window, we need to call a method set visible, and the parameter provided here is true. That means we are making that frame visible. So we shall run this program, and we shall see how the output is. So this is the program here. It is a command prompt, and here we shall switch to the directory, and the directory is Java directory on C drive. And what is the command? Java C, right? To compile a program, we shall use command Java C, and here we shall write a file name, right? Input file name, which is a form1.java, and here just hit enter. right? So there is no problem, and class is successfully compiled, and now we have the output here, form1.class, right? And to run this frame, what we shall do, we shall write here Java, and the class name is form1, right? And here just click enter, and now just see here, friends, right? We have a frame launched here, right? It has a default width and height. It was like this primarily, and now I just resized it, and this is the frame. So you understood what is frame means? A frame is a window in your operating system, right? So now what we are going to see, we shall see the different controls that we can add on this frame to have user interface. And the different controls means different, we can add buttons, we can add text area, we can add text field, we can add labels, and using these controls we are going to create a form. Okay, till this everyone understood?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, great. So now we shall move to the user controls. See, the next class is JPanel, okay? But before that, we shall go to the next screen here. We shall see a J text field and, sorry, J label and J button. So here, what I'll do, I'll modify this program here. See, just understand the process. See, for every control that you want to place on this screen, you need to create the object of that particular control, and after that you will place that object on this frame. How? Just take an example, simple example, J label. What does this class do? This is a class to show any small message or a label on a screen. So here I'll use J label to display a message welcome. Okay, so I'm going to create an object of this class J label, and we shall name it as L1. Okay, here I'll just initialize this class J label, and the parameter here is the text that you want to provide or that you want to show on this label. I'll just change my program. So here we have L1 object, right? And here we shall provide parameter which will be a message to display on this label. So here we shall just write welcome to Java. Okay, and now what we'll do, we'll just simply add, we shall call a method f1.addL1, right? See, it is very simple technique to understand that we are creating a label and we are adding this label to a frame F1, right? Simply compile the program. So here we shall write Java C, and program name is form1.java. Okay. And program is compiled successfully, and here we shall run it like this. So here is the screen, and see, there is a label, right? And what is displayed on that label? Welcome to Java. But we cannot visualize that how is the what is the height of this label, what is the width of this label, but we can visualize the message on that label. So the next step in this process is to provide height and width to any control to fit it on particular portion of this screen. Set bounds. What does this method do? this method provides four parameter to any control. You can use you can use this method with almost all classes which are visual classes. That means J label, J button, J text field. So here parameters are the x axis, y axis, width and height. Just understand what does it means. See, if this is our screen, this is the window, right? So as you understand, the x axis on this window starts with the left side top corner. Left side top corner, the x axis starts here and the left x axis is incremented in fashion, right? So this particular position is a zero x, and here x increases, and similarly y increases downward. So this position, this left side top corner, is always a position 0 0. That means x axis is 0 and y axis is 0, and x axis increments in left to right fashion and y axis increments in top to bottom fashion. Okay, and the third parameter for this method is the width, and the fourth parameter in this method is the height. So what we'll do, we shall provide the bounds to our frame itself first of all. So just change the program. So here for our frame we are providing parameter 100 100 500, and here I'll write 300. So the first parameter is x axis, the second parameter is y, and the third parameter is width, and fourth parameter is height. So just save it, compile it and run. Now see, I'll get this window here. Okay, so just see what we have provided here. We have provided bounds to the frame itself, and the bounds are 100 100 500 300. X is 100, y is 100, width is 500 and height is 300. But see, when you are applying bounds to the frame, bounds to the window, those are calculated relative to your screen, and so window is open at this position because window has calculated 100 from the left side, that means x axis, 100 from the top side, that is y axis, 500 in the width and 300 in the height. So we have frame in this fashion now. Got it? Now next we shall modify this button to have a particular position. See, there are different styles available in Java to apply bounds automatically as well, but we shall see manual fashion only so that you will understand it better. So it is called layout. So when we are going to apply bounds to the control manually, we need to disable the default layout fashion of a frame. So for that we shall apply a method set layout on the frame, because we are going to place controls on frame, so we are going to disable the default layout of a frame. And to disable it, simply call a method set layout and provide a parameter null, so that the default layout will be disabled. And now what we provide, what we are providing as a bounds to any control, those will be in effect. So here L1, we shall provide bounds to L1 here, and the bounds are 10, 15. See, x is 10 here, y is 50, width will be 150, let's say, and height would be 30. And see, the unit of these parameters is pixels, right? You know that screen is calculated in terms of pixels, or we calculate the resolution of screen in pixels. So these bounds are also provided in pixel itself. So the x-axis is 10, y is 50, width is 150, and height is 30. And we are adding this control on F1. So let's compile it. Okay, and run. See, now if you resize this window, the position of that label is fixed, right? And what is the position? See, x is 10, that means 10 pixel from the left, then y-axis is 50, that means 50 pixels from the top, the width is 150 and height is 30. But still we cannot visualize the label. So what we can do, one more method we have is the set background. Now what we can do, we can provide a background color for this label so that we can visualize where is this label is located exactly. We can visualize it using text, but using background you can visualize its height as well as width as well. So we have a method set background, and the parameter that we provide in set background method is the color object, and the color class is available in. To access color class, we need to include package AWT, and here we have a class color which is available in java.awt package. And here what we provide the parameter for this color class are RGB. There are different parameters, but we shall use this parameter, these three parameters. The constructor we are going to use is the constructor which has three parameters, RGB, that means red, green and blue color combination. So simply to get any color, to get these parameters of any color, simply go to paint and just select your color. Suppose we are selecting this color, okay, and see here we have these three parameters. Red is 254, green is 147, and blue is 1. So what we shall do, we shall simply provide these parameters over here: 254, comma, max is 147 and 1. So this is the combination RGB, okay. Now let's compile it first. Okay, that's all. So it is done. And now what we'll do, simply apply this color in this method as the parameter. So in set background method, we are going to use an object of color class, right? So color class is available in java.awt package. And the parameters are provided are red, green, blue, okay? And we can have these values from the paint application, or you can use any graphics application there you can have, or you can use Google as well to get a value of RGB of any color, okay? So here we shall compile it again. So it's done, and just simply run the application. Just a second. It's a by default layout button will not accept color, so we need to use one more method, set opaque. So instead of that, we shall use another class so that we cover another class as well. We are going to use another class is the J panel. So here we shall create GP1 object, and here we shall initialize it. See, here we have object J panel, and what J panel does? J panel is the container, and it contains other controls in it, same like a window, but the window is a parent control, and in that parent control, if you want different parts, different sections, then to define that particular section, you can use JPanel class. So here I'll simply give bounds to this JPanel, and the bounds are suppose 10, width suppose 400, and height suppose 200 is okay. Okay, and we shall add this control on frame. So here JP1. Now see how we are changing the design. Here this label is now available on the panel, and we shall apply this background to this panel. So again, just summarize. We have a panel, JPanel, JP1. We have applied bounds to this panel. We have set a background color to this panel, and this panel is available on frame now. And we have created a label. Label has bounds, and this label is displayed on the panel. It's placed on that panel. Again, just compile it. Okay. So here, Java C form1 dot Java. See, can you visualize it now? Is it visible?
Yes.
See, yes. So we have a frame, right? In that frame, we have placed a panel, and the bounds of panel are, see here. Bounds of panel are 10, 400, and 200, right? So 400 is the width and 200 is the height. Can you imagine? See, width is greater, right? 400, and height is 200. And we have applied a background color which is somewhat similar to this one, right? The parameters are provided here. If you want any other color, just switch the color and just change these values, red, green, blue in this color constructor. Got it? So here is the panel, here is the label. Now what we'll do, we shall move to the another control, and the control is J button. So can you imagine where you will use this J label button? J label control. You will use this label whenever you want to show a message to user. In that case, you will simply use this control J label, and just switch to next control. It is J button, and simply as its name suggests, that this control is used to have action, a click action on your screen. So J button, we shall here name it as a JP1. We shall initialize it J button. Okay, and here again you can provide parameter as a string, and this string will be displayed on this button. So here we shall write click me. So this is the message displayed on button, and simply provide bounds to this button and add it on the panel. So here JP1, okay, J button 1, and here we shall add this button on the panel. Here we shall change the parameters of label. See, 10, 10. So I have moved it to the left. Okay, and now see, now here we need to calculate the position of button. Suppose I need to place this button below the label, then you will need to calculate the position. See, the x-axis of label is 10, the y-axis of label is 10. That means a label is placed on the panel and is skipping 10 pixels from the top. And now just calculate these positions from the left top corner of panel, because when you are going to place this label, this button on the panel, you need to calculate their positions is in respective of the panel, but the panel is placed on the frame, so the position of panel will be in respective of the frame, and frame is displayed on the screen, so the position of the frame will be in respect to the screen itself, right? So when we are placing a label on the position 10 10, and see, this is x-axis and this is the height, and this is y-axis and width. If the y-axis is 10 and the height is 30, that means this label will cover the space from the 10th pixel to the 40th pixel of the panel, so it will cover that much of space. So if you want to place this button, then you need to think about the pixel below the 40th position, right? So here what we'll do, the x position would remain same 10, that means the position from the left would remain same, that is 10, but the vertical axis is going to change because we have a control from a control J label from the 10th pixel to the 40th pixel. So here y axis would be 50. I have given 50. So this J button will start from the 50th pixel on the y axis, right? And the width given is the 150 and the height given is the 30. So actually we don't need 150 width. So what we'll do here, we'll simply make the width as 100. Now just save this program. This button is added on the panel, right? Now simply compile and run it. Java C, compile and run. See, okay, there is one more problem. The J panel control has the default layout as it was for JFrame. So again, we need to disable the default layout for the J panel as well, so that it will take the bounds that we have provided in the program. So what we'll do, simply again, we shall use the same method, set layout, for the panel as well. So here what we'll do, we'll use a method set layout null to the J panel, so that J panel will not give its own bounds, it will accept bounds provided by us, and simply save this program, compile it again, Java C, form1.java, okay, got it, and run it. Okay, so everyone, okay, done. See, the button is placed at the 10 pixel from the left and 10 pixel from the top. Its width is the 150 and height is 30, and button is placed below the label, so the height the y-axis given is the 50. Now let's make it as a 20. Okay, so we shall see whether it going to overwritten this label control. Just compile and expected semicolon is missing there. Okay, sorry. And now simply run it. See, it has overwritten the label control, right? Because the Y positions are overwritten and both control label is placed below the button. So we need to calculate the position of control according to these parameters. So this is the X and this is the width. So using X and width, you will calculate the X position of a control if you are going to place that control in the right side of any control. And if you want to place a control below any control, then you will calculate position according to the y-axis and the height of that particular control. So here y position is 10 and height is 30. So we need to select y position for this control more than 40 only. Got it? So we shall move to the next topic, and that is the next control is the J field and J text area. See, the J text field control is used, as its name suggests, that whenever you want to read anything from the user, that means you want to read any input from the user, in that case you will use control J text field. So we have control J text field here. We'll rename it as J text field 1, JTF1. Okay, this will do. Then to initialize this control, we shall call a default constructor here. Okay, got it. After that, we shall add this control. We shall give bounds to this control, and we shall add this control on the panel again. So here, now see, what would be the panel of this control, JTextField? Suppose we want to place this control on the right hand side of this label. We shall rename this label as full name. And just imagine that this is a student form, and we need to place a label and we need to read username. Okay, so what we'll do, we'll place a label and we will place edit text or a text field after this label. So this label is full name. And see, what is the X parameter? X parameter is 10. And what is the width? It is 150. Actually 100 will do for this much of string. So we'll have 100 over here. And see how much space is acquired by this label. See, X is 10 and width is 100. That means it will acquire space till the pixel 110. So we need to specify a position 110 for this text field. So here I'll write 120, and the Y position would remain same. Why? Because we need to place this control just after the label. So the Y position, right, would remain same. And see, the Y position here is 10, and so Y position for this control would be 10 again. Width 100 will do and height 30 will do. Add this control on a panel and now simply compile. Here, cut it and run. Just a second. What is it? Okay. Sorry. JP1. Okay. And here, control name is not changed, so it was not placed. Got it? This was a mistake. Sorry. Just compile it again. Java C and form1.java. Okay. Simply run. See, there is a label full name, and now we have a text field which is ready to accept user input. Got it? And here I can write my name. That's all. So we have tried four different controls in swing: J frame, J panel, J label, J button, and J text field. Now the next control is J text area. The difference between J text field and J text area is, if you want to read any single line input like a name, like a city name, then you can use J text field. But if you want to read a multi-line input, that means a full address or about yourself, in that case you need to use multi-line text field, and in that case you will use a class J text area. So here simply modify this program to place this control J text area 1. We shall name it as J text area 1. Okay, and here we shall use default constructor again. Now simply provide bounds to this control. So here bounds, and here we shall add this control on the panel. Now see, we need to add this control below a button. So what we'll do, x-axis would remain same. So here we shall use x-axis as 10. But now see, the button is acquiring a space from 50th of 2 axis, right? And its height is 30. So it is acquiring a space from 50 to 30. That means the last position or the bottom position of J button is the 80. The pixel would be 80. So we need to place this control below pixel 80. So we shall use 90. Okay, that's all. Again, here height, for height we shall for width we shall provide parameter 200, and for height we shall provide 60. Okay, that's all. Simply compile. Okay, and run it. Okay, see, we have a text area, a multi-line input control. See, we can add multiple lines. Got it? And this field now can read multi-line inputs from user. So these are the basic controls used in swing. Again, summarize it: J frame and J panel, J label and J button, J text field and J text area. Similarly, we have a J radio button and J checkbox to accept single input from the multiple choice, or the multiple choice input from the multiple choice. That means a J radio button would be used in case of yes no situation, and J checkbox would be used in case of select your hobbies. Okay, we shall skip this part and we shall directly move to the event handling, because this is again interesting part for you. So here what we are going to see, we are going to see how events are performed on controls, and how we can capture those events, and after that how we can perform any action on that particular event. To change the same program to have this, okay, so we shall modify the same program here. See, we have button over here, right? We can have another button. We can simply copy this code, place here, and we shall name it as JB1. Okay, J button, J button 2, and here click me 2. Okay, so this is the next button, and we shall place this button below this text area. So here we shall provide bounds. Again, x axis would be same, y axis would be 90 plus 60 is 150, right? And 150, so we shall place it on 160. Width would be 100, this will do, and height 30 will do, no problem. And here we shall name it JB2. Just compile program and run it. See, we have another button over here. See, now width is not sufficient, so the text is trimmed now. So what we can do here, instead of 100, we can have 150. Okay, so now button is okay. Now after compiling, it will have more space to show this string. Okay, after that we are going to place one label below this button. So again, I'll code for this here. Suppose we have a label L2, and now I'll keep it empty label. Okay, so here we shall place this label below this button. See, we have less height for this panel, so we shall increase the height of this panel. Here the height is 200, we'll make it 300. Okay, to place this label below the button. Okay, and now this button is acquiring space from 160 to 30. That means pixel would be, the last pixel would be 190. So we shall place this label on y-axis 200, width 150 will do, and height is 30. And here what I'll do, I'll just make it as a x. Okay, so that we can imagine where this label is placed. Okay, now just simply compile program and run it. Sorry, there is mistake here. It should be L2, right? Compile program and run it. See, the new label is placed just below this button, and now what our purpose is to click this button. Okay, so I'll click this button, and on click event of this button, we are going to change the text on this label. So what we can do, see, what is event handling? First of all, understand it. See, the button is placed over here, right? We can click it, but there is no action defined for this button, and it is not going to perform any action till we tell that button what to do. When user will click you, what action you should perform. And to tell this, the concept is event handling. So first of all, we need to assign a listener, event listener, for the control. You can assign event different event listener to the different controls. The basic, very basic event listener in Java is the action listener. The action listener is an interface, and we should implement that interface over here first. So here we shall write implements action listener. Again, this listener and the event classes are available in package awt.event. So here what we'll do, we have implemented action listener. So what action listener, what is the purpose of action listener? This action listener has the method. Every listener has different methods to listen different events from the control, and the action listener has the method action performed, and this method should be implemented in our class. So here we need to change our program somewhat to handle this event. So I'll just create one new program. Okay, just a second. You can have form2.java, and here we shall modify the structure of this program like this. We can have a default constructor over here. Okay, from one. And what we'll do, we will simply shift all this code from the main method to the constructor, and we shall keep these two statements over here and see here. We shall simply we can write it here as well. No problem, this will do. And to nullify the layout of the form, okay, everything would remain same, only this will change. Okay, great. And we can move this method from, I had removed this object because we are in constructor itself. So these methods would be called on this object directly. We shall simply compile this. Here I'll write java form2.java, compile it. We have not implemented a method action listener. So what we'll do, action listener has, see what we do when we implement any interface, we need to implement or we need to give body to every method defined in that particular interface, right? So here is the interface action listener, and it has a method action performed. So here this is the definition of that particular method, and we have implemented that method over here now, and simply compile, and yes, it is done. We shall simply run this frame first. Sorry. I think it should be form 2, right? Again, compile and run. So this is the second deployment of same program, and now we have a form, we have a button, and we are defining a method for this button. So that when we click this method, we shall change the message on this label. So simply implement action listener. The first step is the implement action listener, and to define all the methods available in that action listener. And there is only one method, that is action performed. Okay. And the parameter for this method is the action event. What does this parameter do? This parameter tells method more about the action. In simple word, this parameter can be used to get or to detect which control has performed action, because we can have n number of controls on our frame, right? Suppose we have 5 buttons, 10 buttons on a frame, and when button will be clicked, this method action perform method will be called by that button. And in that case, if we want to judge, if we want to find out that which button has called this method, in that case this parameter action event will help us to get the source of that particular event. So here, if button is clicked, this method will get called, and here we shall simply change the text on this particular label. But see, this label is defined locally. That means we cannot use this object in this method. So simply what we'll do, we'll declare this label L2 globally over here on the class level, right? Now we can access this L2 in constructor and in other methods as well. So here, after button gets clicked, what we are going to do, we are going to simply change the text on this label, and to change the label or a text on that particular label, we have a method setText. Okay, the default text displayed on this label is the XX. So here we shall simply write button is clicked, right? So when button is clicked, we shall simply change the text to button is clicked. And now here, see, this is the button, but we have not linked this button to this particular event. And to link this button to this event, what we'll do, we shall add this action listener to these buttons. And to add this action listener to this button, we have a method add action listener. What is the method? It is add action listener. And we need to provide a parameter that who is the action listener. In simple word, we need to specify which class has the method action performed. This method, which class carries or which class defines this method action performed. And in our current situation, the current class only is having this method, and the current class object in a constructor is nothing but this object. So here we shall provide this, and in technical language we shall say we need to provide a listener in the parameter, and the listener in this case is our class only, because our class is implementing this action listener. So here in that case we are going to write this. So see, we have implemented action listener, we have given the body to this method, this method is implemented here, and we are connecting this button using this action listener method to this listener, so that whenever this button is clicked, this method will be called action perform. This object globally again, possibly there is one more error. Action listener system dot out dot println. Hello, we can have a simple output on a command line as well by using the method system.out.println. So we shall simply test it like this. It should not happen. Oh, I'm so sorry. The problem is here. See, we have a class form 2 here. I rename the class form 2. So the object in main method should be form 2, right? So this was the mistake. I named this object as everything is okay. This event perform has no issue. The problem was here. So it's done now, and simply compile it again and run it. See, now I click this button, click me to see. Got it? See, the event is performed, right? We can detect it like this. We have output on command line as well, and the label text is changed. Okay, now screen is visible. So just give me feedback in between, sir. That
yes, sir.
Okay. So screen is visible now. Everyone understood this?
Yes, sir.
That yes, this was done, right? Event was performed successfully.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, we shall move to the next event that we have to check, the mouse event. See, this action listener is used for mostly for a button to have a single click event. There is another listener, that one is mouse listener. This mouse listener is used to listen different events which are performed by using a mouse. So here again, to have these mouse methods, we shall keep this action listener and we shall implement this mouse listener separately, and we shall use this mouse listener to say we can use this for panel. So here again we have a method, it's add mouse listener, and here again we are going to provide who is the listener for this mouse events. So the listener is this class itself, so we are providing a parameter this. So we are adding this mouse listener to the parameter panel one. That means again this panel is capable to handle mouse events, and we shall keep this object outside the constructor so that it would be a global object. So here panel is now applicable or is now capable to handle mouse events. So which are the mouse events available in this mouse listener? So we have method as mouse clicked. The first method is mouse clicked, and the parameter here is the mouse event. Okay, the next method we have is mouse pressed. I'll explain every method. The next method is mouse moved. The next method is the mouse entered, and the next method is the mouse exited. Now see, the effects are specified in names only. First of all, I'll just compile it first. So mouse, okay, one more method is skipped, and that is mouse released. And sorry, this moved method is not part of this mouse listener. Okay, that's all. So we have these many methods available in mouse listener. The first one is mouse click. This event is performed when a mouse is clicked. See, mouse click is the combination of two events, mouse pressed and mouse released. So in between also, if you want to listen to event that when mouse is pressed and when mouse is released, okay, and the combination is called click. So you can listen that method as that event as well using this method mouse pressed. So when you press the mouse, this method is performed, and when you release the mouse, this method is performed, and the combination of both, for that combination clicked method is performed. What is the enter? Enter is when mouse enters in the area of that particular control, this enter method is called, and when mouse exits from the area of that control, this exited method is called. We shall simply add a system or out dot println over here. We shall click, we shall have message like this, clicked, pressed, released, enter, and the last one is exited. So we have this event. Simply compile and run. Now just see, friends, the listener is applied to the panel. Got it? Listener is applied to the panel. So the panel will give you feedback for every event. So see, I am going to enter this mouse in the panel like this, right? See, the first output is here, mouse enter. Now I'll just exit this mouse from the panel and we have the next output as mouse exited. And if I'm going to perform this event again and again, we have the output, mouse enter, mouse exit, mouse enter, mouse exit, mouse enter, mouse exit, right? That is the enter and exit method. Now I'll click on this panel and I'm going to keep the pressed event like this. So I have pressed mouse, but I have not released it. So the method performed here is mouse pressed. Okay. See, the last output is it is mouse pressed, and I am now going to release the button. So the method is performed as released, right? And the combination press and release, the combination is clicked, and that is the final output. So I am just going to perform this method again, action again and again, and now we have the output as mouse press, mouse release, mouse click, right? Got it? So we capture different events of mouse using mouse listener, and you can have this listener to almost any control of this swing. Okay, so we can apply mouse listener to panels, text feed, text area, label, button. But the action listener was for button only, right? So this is the next topic, and we shall move to the final topic, that is key listener. See, we got the event from mouse, and if we want to listen events from the keyboard, then we have a key listener. So here what we'll do, we'll simply modify the same program, and here I'm going to implement a key listener. Okay, and obviously key listener should be attached to any control which control will accept input from the keyboard. So we'll apply this key listener to the J text field. We have this object, right? Again, we shall move this object outside the constructor at the class level, and here what we'll do, we'll add this listener, add key listener to this text field. Again, who is the listener? This is the listener. And we have different methods for this key event as well, right? And these methods are key pressed, okay? And the event object is the key event in this case. Key pressed, key released, key typed. The next method is the key typed. So we have three different methods to this listener. That's all. So see, key pressed, again, as you can imagine, key press is the event when key is pressed, it is down. Key release is the event when key is released after press. That means you release the key, and the combination of both key press and key release is the key type. So again, here what we'll do, we shall simply output the event as key pressed, key released, and key typed. Simply compile and see, the listener is applied to the text field, right? This J text field, right? That means first input field. So run it and just check. See, the first input is obviously this one, right? So now I'm just going to press a button A, C. We have this output, key pressed, key typed, key released. Got it? And now I'll randomly click different buttons. See, now I'm typing my name. So as you can see, there is a combination of different events, key release, key press, key type. Got it? So event is performed on the text field. So friends, just summarize what we have done. We saw the difference between AWT and Swing. We saw the JFrame and JPanel objects, how to use, then JLabel, JButton, JTextField, JTextArea, JRadioButton, JCheckbox. This is actually simple, but we skipped it. Just a second, I'll just create simple object of it and I'll show you how does it look. JRadioButton. So JR1 equal to new J radio button. Okay, you can provide a label, or you can say yes. Okay, just provide bounds and add it to the panel. So I'll add it below this label. So it's Y panel, Y axis is 200 and height is 230. So that here I'll write 240, width 150 is enough. And next is the J checkbox. J checkbox. So here JC1. Here we'll use constructor as J checkbox. Again, JC1. JC1, and here we shall place it below the radio button. That means 270, and here it will be 280. What is the pan height? It is 400. It is enough. Sorry, 300. So we'll make it as 400 and just compile and run. See, now see, it is called a radio button. Got it? And this is called a checkbox. So these are the controls. Okay. What is next? Next, we saw the action listener and the mouse listener. Then we saw a key listener. Okay. So this was the topic from advanced Java. Okay. Everyone got it? Okay. Can I conclude it then? So friends, see, these are my details, and you can connect me on social media as well. Also, I run YouTube channel and the name is the Deepak Master. You can subscribe to this channel. You will get very informative and development related videos on this channel. I have started it before 1-2 months only. So there are many new development programs are scheduled on this channel. So kindly subscribe to this channel. It is the Deepak Master. You can search about Byte System on Google or Facebook. Then you can ask your doubt on WhatsApp as well. My number is provided, or you can send us mail. My mail ID is also provided. So kindly subscribe our channel, and if you have any doubt, you can ask me on the channel as well. That's all, friend. Thank you.
Sir.
It was great session, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much for inviting. Thank you, sir.
So, Ghanshyam sir, thank you so much for conducting such a wonderful session on Java programming language. So, on behalf of Guru Gobind Singh Polytechnic and Computer Engineering Department, I really thank you for conducting such a wonderful session and giving your valuable time and guidance to all our students.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It was a pleasure.